Okay, well, I have 11:31 here, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. Welcome, everybody, to another opening assembly under less than ideal conditions. I wish we were all together, or at least virtually together, even across the state and up to Alaska. We're going to go through some slides today, but we do have more time than we did during the fall opening assembly. And that's partly because you spoke and we listened. We had to get through things fairly quickly in the fall. And what we decided to do was give an extra half an hour. If we use it, we use it. If we don't, that's okay. But we should have time for Q&A. And related to Q&A, we have Ginny Larimar here again. Thank you, Ginny, for supporting us. You can, and Ginny, I don't know, do you paste your instructions into the chat box? Is it already there?
Do it right now, done.
Okay, so if you wanna submit questions, you can do it through the chat. If you wanna do it anonymously, you can send them through to Ginny, and she will ask them for you at the end of the slide deck. And as we go through, if you have questions, for example, about budget, just make sure you pop those in when they're fresh in your mind, and we'll get to them as we, Ginny will go back through them as we get to the Q&A section. Anything else you wanna add, Ginny, about that?
No, that's great. I'll just keep an eye on it and add questions to the queue as they come in, and I'll wait for your queue when it's time for me.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you again for being here. We did solicit feedback from the last opening assembly, and one of the things that people did suggest was moving it back to lunchtime and on a Friday. So we've done that today. Hopefully that helps with our turnout and our engagement. We added some time to it. We get a lot of comments each time about where are the street tacos, and we don't have those back yet, but we'll make sure that we do when we get to be together in person. Hopefully that will be the fall opening assembly. And those of you that commented that you wanted a new vice president for health sciences, we haven't made that change quite yet either, although that might be coming. I'm just kidding. So we do have a lot to cover today, and I'm not going to go through the entire agenda, but we're going to talk a little bit about COVID. I know that people are curious as to what's going on with some of our searches, in particular the College of Health Dean. Leanne provided us with some great MarCom updates. We have some updates from Shannon Oler and Chris Owens and the recruiting and advising team. And then we'll talk a little bit about budget and where we are with that. Joe Wilcox and Brian Hickenlooper are here. And if we have detailed questions or things that I need some support on, Joe is ready to answer some questions. We'll also look at our priorities and where we are in terms of moving ahead with program growth, some ideas around interdisciplinary collaboration, and also some diversity initiatives that I think we're gonna be finally making some progress on. The ICHR, the Idaho Center for Health Research, has a nice report, and that transitions into some of our looks at our scholarly productivity in terms of grants and contracts received and the revenue that's generated by those of you that are doing that important work. Faculty Senate also has provided us with some updates and asked for additional input from the faculty and faculty engagement. And then we have just a brief section on KDHS news, some student highlights, and some other announcements. The other thing that we will do is I'll transition to our traditional new employees slideshow when we move into the Q&A. So Ginny, what I'll do, and if I forget, if you wouldn't mind reminding me, as we're Rex, answering questions.
Sorry, Rex, you froze for just a second. You stopped at, if you wouldn't mind reminding me.
Oh, I guess you do need to know what you need to be reminded of. So if you wouldn't mind reminding me to switch to the other slide deck. I have two slide decks, and that second one is our new employees, and we'll just let that cycle as we answer the Q&A. I did get a internet stability warning at my end. And I've kicked everybody out of the house today. But if that happens again, let me know and I'll rewind a little bit. We should have good throughput, but sometimes we still have problems. So just related to COVID, I know people are tired of COVID, and more COVID, but there are a few things that I wanted to touch upon. First of all, I wanted to thank all of you for adapting to difficult times and still supporting one another, supporting faculty and staff, supporting our clinics, supporting, most importantly, our students. So thank you all for the work that you have done over the last almost year dealing with COVID. I also want to thank the COVID Health Committee because it's made up of a lot of people that have dropped everything that they've been doing in their regular day jobs to be able to support, particularly the contact tracing related to health and safety on campus. And if we were here together, I'd ask people to give these folks a standing ovation because they really have spent an incredible amount of time. Cassidy McKay, Lewis Eakins from Public Safety, and before Lewis was part of the health team, Chris Boyce, Ryan Lindsay from our Community and Public Health Department, Chris Owens, Jennifer Parrott, who's from Environmental Health and Safety, and Ron Solbrig, our retired Director of University Health. We also have hired some folks that have spent a tremendous amount of time behind the scenes doing contact tracing, Lindsay Morris and David Jenkins, and also Addison Biasan and Adam Ernst have been our CPIs over the course of particularly the fall, and we appreciate their help. The COVID hotline, the COVID email gets dozens, if not even hundreds, some days of emails and phone calls, and these folks help to manage all of that, to do the contact tracing that's occurred with cases on our campus. And we've seen a bit of an increase of that work with our screening program. And I just wanted to, you know, really acknowledge those folks and give them a little hand, even if you do it with your with your little emojis on the screen, because they really have spent an incredible amount of time. The COVID screening program, and I'm happy to answer questions about the COVID screening program, is ongoing. We've had to make several mid-course corrections with the screening program. First, because of issues related to supply chain, the lab that we were working with received 200,000 defective vials, those small vials that many of you have had to drool into. And so that ended up causing delays the first week of our screening program. And then the lab that they are standing up in Sunnyvale, California, our partner Shield T3, had some staffing issues at that lab. And we had to pause last Friday and this Tuesday and adjust this program to only have a single test done during the month of January. So everyone has time to do that. We have sites set up on both the Pocatello and the Meridian and Idaho Falls campuses. We have contingency plans in place for Alaska and for anybody that's in Twin Falls as well, to be able to be screened one time during this time period. We still have several hundred folks that have not done their screening and are not yet in the appointment system for screening. So please get into the portal, get signed up for your screening before the 29th. We also will have an ongoing screening program throughout the semester. This will be available for enhancing our contact tracing. It will also be available for special programs that have increased risk, those programs that might have health exceptions in place, and also our athletics programs and students that are living in on-campus housing will likely be prioritized for the ongoing screening, although this will be at a much lower level of tests per week than we are currently doing with the all-campus one-time screening. So again, if you have any questions about this, happy to turn back to it when we get to the Q&A. I know that many of you have been to some of the other town halls where we've talked about this program. And if you have special needs in your programs for additional screening because of, you know, whatever factors, factors that you're operating under a health exception or just concerns about health and safety in those programs, you certainly can approach the COVID health team and we can arrange that sort of ongoing screening or special screening approaches as we move through the semester. The other big issue that is coming up now is vaccination. Where are we with vaccination? We've had one large group meeting on vaccination. It was just yesterday. And we have several different issues that we are working through. That is from things like our folks that are working in clinics and that are healthcare providers, where are they in the vaccination process? I know many of them have received vaccination through channels with health departments. Also our students that are out on clinical rotations, many of those individuals have received vaccination through their clinical site, perhaps, or also through the health department. But we are working on university policies and recommendations. And if you would like input into that, we certainly would receive that at the health committee. Chris Owens is helping to lead our vaccination efforts. And Lewis Eakins is also a big part of that process. So feel free to reach out to them to provide input. And we will be soliciting campus input. There's a survey that's going to come out, as well as the special needs that your programs might have in this regard. We want to hear from you and hear what your students and faculty and staff are saying as we move towards a vaccination program. At this point, at least in Southeast Idaho, the volume of vaccine that's being received is not allowing us to look at more widespread vaccination than what's currently being recommended in that tiered approach that the state of Idaho has modeled after the Centers for Disease Control. But we will, as we move through the semester, obviously be ramping up both our collaborations with the local health departments, as well as on-campus vaccine initiatives. And again, we want your input into that process. I would like to announce, and I'm happy to announce, very happy to announce, that Teresa Connor will be joining us as the College of Health Dean. She will be joining us in late March. So it's exciting to see that we're going to have a new member join our leadership team. Dr. Connor is extremely excited to be a part of Idaho State University, and I know many of you interacted with her, at least virtually, during her visit here. She is extremely interested in things like creating opportunities for first-generation students, creating innovation opportunities, and developing new curricula, new degrees, collaborations with other entities on campus, especially the other deans and the other colleges, to create innovative new programs. And she is very excited to be joining us in just a couple of months, and we're excited to have her. I want to thank Chris Brock from CSD, who was the chair of the search committee, and the rest of that search committee. Leslie Stewart, Jason Pilarski, Maggie Mann from Southeast Idaho Health, Public Health, Randy Hudspeth from the Nurse Leaders of Idaho, Justin Lee from the Social Work Department, John Grievous, who's an associate dean in Cal, Evan Papa, Gina Clarkson, and Tara Smith, Garrett Condelario, a lab science student, and Tom Murphy, a DNP student, rounded out that search committee. They did an outstanding job prioritizing applicants, conducting a search in a very difficult time where we had short, compressed timelines to work through this process. We had candidates that had other job opportunities, and we had to deal with travel restrictions and issues around COVID. This team did a great job working through that entire process. And we were able to land what I think is an outstanding new dean in the College of Health. And I'm very excited to have her join us. I see Gabe Bargan on my little screen here. Gabe, I want to thank you personally for stepping up to be the interim executive director in Meridian. You had to step in the middle of standing up testing and screening, for example, even well before your start date, you were engaged in that process. And Gabe, I really appreciate you doing that, and welcome to the leadership team. And everybody, I think Gabe deserves a hand for stepping up in difficult times and being a big part of the transitions that are occurring on the Meridian campus. We have a search committee formed up for the next executive director of the Meridian campus. And the first meeting, we're still working through a doodle poll and that sort of thing, but it will be scheduled towards the end of January, the first part of February, to initiate the search for a permanent executive director of that campus. We also are searching at the present time for a director of university health. We've been through one search cycle, and that was unsuccessful, unfortunately. So we're going to be reconfiguring that search a little bit and moving forward with a search for the director of university health. And we've just completed some interviews for the department chair of dental hygiene. I know we're still in negotiations with the top candidate there, and we'll hopefully have an announcement here fairly soon. As of yesterday, I haven't talked to anybody today, but as of yesterday, we still were waiting to hear on where we were with our offers with that individual. So those are some, I guess, administrative searches that are still ongoing. I want to transition a little bit towards some of the things that Leanne Waldron has provided related to our marketing and communication efforts. We've initiated what we're calling the Preceptor of the Month program. And so we want your involvement in this program, your nominations with people you feel are outstanding preceptors for our students. Obviously, preceptor involvement is critical to the success of our programs. At Thanksgiving, we put out some advertisements in the Treasure Valley as well as in the Pocatello media about thanking our community preceptors that contribute so much to our programs. So if you have preceptors that you'd like to highlight, and we can do this over time because we're trying to do this every month, please contact Leanne to nominate individuals who could be a part of that program. This will highlight our programs, but also thank those individuals and those partners that contribute so much to our students. We have some other highlights that Leanne provided, and thank you, Leanne, for doing that. We have received a tremendous amount of earned media coverage from the pieces that Leanne and her team have produced. Chris Cole, some CPIs, and other individuals that help to produce that, including those of you from the programs that send her ideas and thoughts about how we can highlight our programs. This contributes up to $250,000 in earned media coverage from the pieces that are produced here. And Leanne and you all have helped to establish relationships with multiple healthcare and science journalists who look to ISU as an important subject matter expert when it comes to all kinds of things. And I know I've done a few interviews. Ron Solbrig has done interviews. Ryan Lindsay's done interviews related to COVID and the university's response. Many of you have also contributed in those efforts, and we really appreciate you making yourselves available to highlight the expertise that resides here within the Division of Health Sciences. There's been a lot of social media work, and I appreciate all the throughput on all of our different social media channels for us to really create enhancements to the visibility of our programs and to the activities of our students, as well as our faculty and staff related to the health sciences here at ISU. One of the things that's happened is Leanne's been able to establish an enhanced key social media connections with influencers like St. Luke's, St. Al's, the governor's office, and we'll highlight that again on an upcoming slide. This has led to an increase in followers on our social media platforms, and we want to increase that. So if you can follow our programs and you share our stories that are out there, whether it's Instagram or Facebook, that enhances the overall visibility of these programs. So I would encourage you to do that. We also, as part of our strategy, are looking to promote programs with lower application enrollment numbers, as well as our new programs to potential students as we move for targeting our advertising moving forward. Part of this digital advertising strategy is to increase the number of programs utilizing this digital advertising for recruitment. We can study the analytics to form and revise our strategies and to improve the quality of the visual materials that we have. And those are things that Leanne's very much interested in getting your feedback on and your participation in. But some of the results that we've seen are increases in applicant numbers for programs that have utilized these strategies. We saw an increase in out-of-state applicants for pharmacy, which is something that we were targeting because our program needs additional applicants. And when those applicants come from out of state, frankly, they're getting a better value than staying in state in many of our local states, whether it be Washington, Oregon, or California. We want to increase the number of applicants who report seeing, we have seen an increase in the applicants who have seen ISU ads online and increases in web and phone inquiries based upon these social media efforts. So I really appreciate Leanne and her team increasing the throughput and all of your participation in doing that. We also want to do more video. So we want to use more video for recruitment, for public relations. I know many of you have already done this. We've produced some video ads and different program videos that are out there, and we want to continue to do this. Video has become such an important thing for our partners as well as for prospective students and the general public. We continue to have print and outdoor ads and sponsorships as part of our strategy, including use of newspaper and Chamber of Commerce. And in local high schools, we have banners up promoting the Division of Health Sciences and our programs. And obviously one of the big highlights was the governor getting his flu vaccine this October on our Meridian campus with our students. And that was a fantastic thing, and appreciate all the coverage and all the organization that occurred there on the Meridian campus to make that happen. In terms of the directions that we want to move here for 2021, one of the things that Leanne and I have talked about, and I know she's talked with you individually in the programs, is to help increase traffic and the revenue in our clinics. Obviously, we have new clinics on Meridian and a great new clinic layout and great interdisciplinary opportunities there. We want to enhance that and obviously publicize that to the community to increase the training opportunities for our students, but also the care that we're providing. Strategically, we can showcase the economics and social impacts of our programs and our clinics. That's something that Leanne is going to be working on. Expand even further that earned media coverage, particularly in the Treasure Valley. Continue to study the faculty and staff input to determine the most effective ways that we share our information out, and to continue to use digital advertising to grow applicant enrollment and enrollment numbers across the division. And I think these are fantastic goals, Leanne, and I appreciate you working on all of that. As we transition here a little bit, but related, Shannon Oler, Chris Owens, and their team in recruiting and advising are working on several initiatives. And one of those, and you're going to be hearing from Shannon soon, if you haven't already, is the development of a recruiting timeline by department so that we can line up different events and make sure that our org, our efforts are coordinated and organized when our recruitment and advising folks are out in the community and talking with prospective students and promoting our programs. So to organize all of that, Shannon's going to put together timelines of recruitment by department. She also wanted to thank everybody for their participation in new student orientation, which was held on January 8th. And I think it's really fantastic, all of the contributions that we had across the division to be able to participate virtually in meeting our new students. So important. And that was even, you know, sort of before we were really fully back from the holiday break. Thank you all for your help with that. The other highlights that are coming out of the recruiting and advising office include the Associate of Science in Health Science. That new degree was approved and will be available for students starting in fall of 2021. Obviously, that will articulate well with our BS in HS. I want to thank Dana Gaudet, Chris Owens, and all of you that participated in getting that new degree up and running. I think it will be marketed. Whoops. Sorry about that. I was playing with my mouse and it ran ahead on me. It will be marketed at the Medical Arts Charter School in Meridian, but also more widely across the state. We will have very shortly an opening in our Health Sciences Advisor Group. And I haven't really told anybody of this, but I really want to see a focus on minority recruitment and stepping up our game, particularly for Hispanic and Latinx students and Native American students as part of our advising and recruitment focus. So that's going to be coming. We'll talk a little bit about this on our diversity page slide coming up in a minute. I wanted to also provide just a little bit of an enrollment update based upon what happened in the fall. Obviously, we've been working from a budgetary perspective at difficult numbers coming out of enrollment. But it really wasn't as bad as it could have been and as many universities experienced in the fall. At the end of term numbers, our enrollment was 12,339, which was a decline of 4%, 508 students. However, a good number of those students, over half, were early college students. This is dual enrollment. And that was severely disrupted this year by the high schools and the way that they rolled out their in-person or lack of in-person education at the high schools. And so, when we look at excluding those individuals, those early college students, which obviously are important to our ongoing matriculations, the decline was only about 200 students or 2%. Credit hour production was down about 3%. But really, considering everything that happened, that's not too bad. And the silver lining here is that graduate enrollment increased by 147 students or 7.2% at ISU. And I know that a lot of that was in the division. Many of our programs are in the state of expansion or have been expanding. And much of this student growth is attributable to the efforts that all of you have done to grow our programs, grow our program offerings and expand what we are doing on both campuses. So thank you. That's a huge part of the budget picture, as well as just where we need to be going in terms of growth overall. At this point in time, spring enrollment is down 0.9% from last year at this time, which is pretty darn good given given where we are still dealing with the pandemic. There are 2,800 students currently enrolled in the DHS. This includes a few undecided students that look like they're ours. 85% of continuing students at the university as a whole have registered. 87% of those in the DHS are registered. And we expect that these numbers will change a little bit, even over the first few days, because 10th day enrollment is not set until January 26th. So we literally are coming very close to matching last spring's enrollment. And if there's anything you can do in your programs to reach out to students that may still be undecided or having a difficult time, please do so. And if there are things that we can do at the divisional office to help support that, if people are in need of you know, special accommodations related to financial aid or other issues that are happening in their lives that are preventing them to come back, we would like to hear about that and hear about how we can better support that. The university is very much behind these students and will help them in any way to move forward in their degree path. I'm going to transition a little bit to budget and talk about where we are, what our budget looks like, and the budget process for fiscal year 22. Our total budget, when you look at all sources, that is local, appropriated, and grant, is just under, just right at about $50 million. And when we look at the sources of funding, it's about 14% grant funding and almost identical when we look at local and appropriated dollars. Remember, appropriated dollars include both general fund monies that come from the state and tuition that is returned to the division. Those are the two components of appropriated money. Local revenue is a huge part of what we do. This comes from professional fees, but also from clinic revenues within the division. When we look at labor as a fraction of our budget, it's about 80%, and 20% are other direct expenditures. But as you would expect, labor is the vast majority of what we pay for with that budget. Going into planning for FY22, we are in a much better position than we were last year. We essentially had across the university a 15 to maybe even 16 or $17 million deficit, functional deficit that we were operating under. And we had to hold back money. We had to create budget cuts in our budgets, and then we had to hold back even more when the governor asked us to hold back an additional 5%. Now, the good news is that the governor's budget proposal, this is not the final number because the legislature has to act on the governor's proposal, but the governor's proposal does include the 5% that he has asked us to hold back in the last year. Meaning that the university's base budget will go from that 95% back up to last year's 100% number. That being said, the university is still working with a functional deficit due to enrollment issues. And so even though we're in a much better position, we are probably not going to see much of that 5% functionally at the division level or at the college or department level because we're still dealing with that deficit situation. Now, that could change if enrollment, for example, in the fall bounces up dramatically. You all have done an outstanding job managing through the disruptions of COVID, carefully balancing revenue and expenditure. Obviously, many of our expenditures have gone down. Some have gone up because of COVID, but certainly travel has gone down while continuing to serve our students in the best possible way. And I thank you for all of the efforts that you've done there. This has not been a pleasant year from a budget perspective. The good news is, and I know it's nice to hear a little bit of good news, is that no furloughs or cuts are expected in FY22. And we do expect a modest CEC, that's change in employee compensation. That's the That's the legislature's nomenclature for raises. We do expect a small raise to be included in the budget. It certainly was in the governor's proposed budget. Again, the legislature will act on the governor's proposed budget and determine what that number is in final form. Probably in February or March, we will know where we stand with the percent CEC that will occur at the higher ed level or state employees in general. Remember, that's always a tricky thing to implement at the university because that raise comes on general fund money. And if we're not having a tuition increase and we're not having a professional fee increase, which we likely will for professional fees, but likely won't for undergraduate tuition, we have to then figure out how we're going to fund that raise for those parts of the budget that are not funded by the legislature. So there will be some tricky machinations that will occur when we roll out how we're going to handle whatever CEC the legislature decides upon later in the spring here. This is the budget philosophy that's stated on the Finance and Business Affairs webpage. And I just want to go over it because transparency is really being highlighted. And we're going to have budget engagement process as we roll out the budget planning initiative here. And I just want to go over this briefly. The university budgets need to be developed transparently, and we're supportive of that. It's collaborative, it's iterative, and it's mission-driven. Resources are prioritized to support and enhance student success, as well as recruitment and access. These are presidential goals with the state board to enhance student success and to create access for our students, to enhance retention, persistence, the ease of transfer to our institutions, and timely degree completion. The quality of our programs is the highest priority. And so we want to make sure that we are maintaining quality as best as possible, given the state of affairs from a budgetary perspective. And we will maintain or enhance excellence in research, scholarship, and creative activity, which contributes to the state's economy and enriches society. And I'll show you some slides in a minute. Our division has done an outstanding job in very, very difficult circumstances to write grants and to get those grants funded over the last year. The university will also preserve its statewide presence, reach communities, create access and cultural opportunities, as well as our clinical services. I just wanted to go over that because those are the underpinnings of the budgetary process, as stated, not by me. These come from our Office of Finance and Business Affairs, but I certainly support the directions that are being outlined here. Our budget engagement plans were due last week. We asked for those from the departments as well as the colleges, and there will be an implementation of that process over the coming weeks. There are budget forum town halls. One of those occurred earlier this week, and there's a second one in mid-February. There's a schedule, and all of this timeline is outlined on the isu.edu/budget webpage. You're welcome to check that out. For FY 2022, ISU will not be requesting an increase to base undergraduate tuition or an increase in student activity fees. We are in the process, and all of you participated in this at the department level, we are in the process of looking at what our professional fee increases should be, if any, and how we are requesting that will be vetted through a variety of different processes over the next couple of weeks. And then all of the student activity fee as well as professional fee goes out for public comment to the university. And there's a process for that to be done on our campuses. It will then go to the state board, the tuition and fee and professional fee information. It will go to the state board for approval or modification at the April meeting. So the other timelines that are important here, the professional fee recommendations and our student activity fee narratives are due just in the next few days. The general budget planning is due on the 5th of March. And that's the same time that strategic investment proposals are due. These are investments that would utilize reserves or reallocation of budget to contribute to some of those overall goals that we just talked about. But program growth, for example, might be one of those where we are requesting strategic investment for a program to grow. The budget presentations are then due in early April, and we will do those at Leadership Council and at Administrative Council to do that final budget setting process. The college budgets will be done for the College of Pharmacy and College of Health. Obviously, we'll need input from the schools and from the departments within the College of Health. And Meridian and the DHS central budget, we will work on those together. So Gabe and her team on the Meridian campus will work with Chris Owens and me and Joe Wilcox for the DHS and Meridian budgets too. So what priorities do we have outlined for the group? Obviously, student connections are our number one priority, particularly as we're continuing to deal with the disruptions of COVID. Recruitment and retention, early assurance programs, and being creative in our programs to be able to identify pathways and pipelines for students to come into our professional programs is extremely important. Articulation agreements with community colleges to enhance that are other things that we're working on. And in fact, we have some of these articulation plans coming online with nursing, for example, right now with our community college partners. And I want to thank Karen and her team for getting those in place and for being able to grow the curricular pathways that are present for students to come in with an LPN and a BS completion, an RN, ADRN and a BS completion into our programs and grow that, particularly in collaboration with the College of Southern Idaho. But those are things that I think we should be thinking about more and more in all of our programs if we don't already have them in place. And I know some of you do. In terms of priorities for the spring, obviously recruitment and retention is always going to be at the top of our list. The president has asked that that be at the top of our list whenever we talk about our programs. And I know that we are very successful at retaining students and supporting students in our programs. We're going to have to continue to be very responsible fiscally. We will have to continue to support our students with online learning because things really haven't changed. Hopefully for the fall, we can move back towards a new normal. And we're obviously going to be working at implementing that Associate of Science in Health Science, looking at where we can grow our programs and programmatic offerings. We're going to be dealing with the program health assessment, and I have another slide on that, and I may ask Chris to chime in a little bit because he's worked with all of your programs on the program assessment timeline. And we are going to be developing new budget models across the university to deal with the revenue side of the budget moving forward, and that will take some time. I don't see it being implemented in time for the FY22 budget process, but it will likely be in place for FY23. There are several programs that are looking to grow next year. Community and Public Health has put together a variety of different certificates. We also are implementing an articulation agreement for the Masters of Public Health for ICOM students, and I want to thank Community and Public Health for putting those programs together. Nursing is growing, the Psych Mental Health Nurse Practitioner Program, and accelerated nursing is likely coming online in the not too distant future in Pocatello. There's a pre-PA minor that has just been approved and a minor in healthy aging. And we're expecting that the second class in rehabilitation counseling will also contribute to increased student numbers moving forward. So program health and sustainability, this process is underway at the program department and college level. Beginning February 19th, the programs will begin to develop action plans that are looking at ways to improve health. Action plan does not mean these programs that are in the lower quartiles are going to be shut down. Action plan means that these programs need to look at ways to shift, to create new opportunities to recruit students and grow enrollment, and to potentially reallocate resources to support those programs. This has all been based on guidance and feedback from Faculty Senate, the Council of Deans, and Administrative and Leadership Councils. And Chris Owens, I don't know if you have anything you want to add about the timeline and the workflow that might be occurring over the next few weeks.
Yeah, I guess I would just say first, thanks to everyone, program directors working with your departments to bring together all the information that was asked for in terms of creating your narratives and scoring your programs on those different areas. And that was a lot of work. It was a very collaborative effort on your part at the department level, which really was the major input that we have at this point. We're at the college level right now, and actually, those college quintiling decisions were supposed to have been sent to academic affairs last week. However, we did receive an extension in the Division of Health Sciences simply because of our resources being so caught up in the COVID response. I basically just begged for a little extra time and I got it. So basically what you have done is great. I have read through many of those narratives. Actually, I have communicated with program directors as they were developed. We have developed a draft of a quintiling scheme based on the ratings that you provided. I just want to reiterate the fact that those bottom two quintiles just need a plan about how you're going to address the health of that program. It's not about shutting them down. It's not about anything punitive. It's about what can we do to help increase the health of those programs. So we're going to be moving with that quintiling step within the next week. That's the extension that I was given. These timelines will still hold as far as I know. As far as February 19th, we'll be getting back with programs to say, all right, let's work together on developing that plan.
Awesome. Thank you, Chris. And thanks for your help with all of that. And I know it was a heavy lift for people to do right here as we ended the semester and moved through the holiday break, but appreciate everybody getting that work done. So I wanted to talk a little bit about interdisciplinary collaborations. And I think that, you know, following on the heels of program health, when we talk about ways that we could, you know, shift the way that we teach, the way that we deliver programs, the way that we develop new programs, there are some opportunities and I think some very willing collaborators across the university. And so this has been, I guess, a focus area of President Satterley. It also is definitely on the radar of several of our other deans, our other colleagues within the university. And I would just like for, and I know that it's on the radar of Teresa Connor, who is going to be starting here mid-semester. The ideas here that we can generate to come up with new degrees, joint degrees, other opportunities to collaborate, for example, on the business of healthcare with Shane Hunt and his team at the College of Business, or collaborate with engineering. If there are opportunities, for example, in our rehab science or within nursing or pharmacy, where we could leverage some collaboration with these other entities, we should be thinking creatively about this. And Chris said that, you know, this quintiling is, and I think I said it too earlier, is not about closing programs down, but it may be about shifting the focus of some of these programs and creating other opportunities that might appeal to students, or even adding additional degrees. So I think sometimes we get very focused on our own curricula and what we've always done. And I think that's fine because what we've always done has been to train outstanding healthcare providers. But I do think there are new areas and new opportunities for us to collaborate within the university to create new degree offerings and joint degrees. And I just wanted to talk briefly about that. We have some ideas in this regard. I know that Teresa Connor will hit the ground with some ideas in this regard. She talked about some of this with many of you while she was here. And I think that there are opportunities for us to really do some creative things and create some new degrees and new collaborations across the university. And I want us to all be very creatively focused on some of this innovation. We also have some other initiatives that are going at the university level and also within the division to look at some of the issues around diversity. One of the things that Adam Bradford, our Dean of the Graduate School, is very interested in and has implemented at other institutions are cluster hire initiatives. These are initiatives where we intentionally work together in how we're hiring to address problems related to diversity. And one of the first things that we talked about was rurality, right? How do we better recruit students from rural areas and have faculty that have the perspectives, the passions, the interest in these kinds of initiatives? And so as we hire additional faculty over the coming years, we will be thinking about how do we then collaborate with engage in cluster hire initiatives, whether it's recruiting diverse faculty or recruiting faculty who are interested in diverse kinds of initiatives. It can be both. Then we will collaborate with other entities on campus and have a more focused and engaged hiring process. As I mentioned earlier, one of the things that I'm very much interested in doing is enhancing our outreach to underserved and diverse populations. Again, these are students that are coming from rural areas. These are our Latinx and Hispanic students, which are obviously a tremendous growth area for the state of Idaho. And it's engaging Native American students as well. I serve as the co-chair of our Tribal University Advisory Board, and I also sit on the Idaho Indian Education Committee, a subcommittee of the State Board of Education. And I can tell you that there are lots of initiatives and lots of needs for us to reach out to the tribal communities to potentially enhance the health professionals that we're training, but also just support those students on their path through higher ed. And so those are some things that are going to be coming, and I'll be asking for folks to be engaged in that process and asking for some creative ideas for how we can enhance the recruitment, retention, and production of a diverse workforce that reflects the populations that we should be serving as we create new healthcare professionals for the state. We've been talking for several months about the diversity committee within the division, and Leanne Waldron has taken a keen interest in that. Walter Fitzgerald has also indicated interest, and several of you I've talked with about being a part of this diversity committee. And I will take some responsibility for not getting this moving. It's been partly related to COVID and some of the demands that have been placed on many of us related to the pandemic response. But we are going to have our first meeting here coming up very soon to begin talking about a work plan, charges, and the directions that our diversity committee should be working in. And I remember a meeting, we talked about this at our extended HSAC, and I think it was Bill Woodhouse who said, we need outputs from this group. And I agree, we need to come up with what is it that our diversity committee wants to work on? What are those initiatives? What are those outputs, those metrics that we can measure and follow that relate to enhancing and creating a diverse, a supportive, diverse work environment and educational environment that is, as I said earlier, reflective of the students that we should be serving and the populations that we serve in terms of provision of healthcare and that we're turning our students out into across the state of Idaho and beyond. So that is coming. We'll continue to have that dialogue. And I'm really excited about some of these initiatives because there's a lot of great opportunity here. The ICHR, the Idaho Center for Health Research, has provided a few slides. Their goal is to foster interprofessional and collaborative research, promoting wellness and health outcomes. If you have not gotten engaged with this group, you absolutely should. This group has had some tremendous accomplishments this year, submitting 24 grants with $7.6 million. 14 of those funded, nearly $1 million in funding received this year. Three grants are pending review with another $2 million. Obviously, this group can support you as a new investigator or an established investigator, because there's a lot of different activities that this group is working on to enhance our scholarship. One of those was a mock grant review process and some speed networking. There was a mock grant review that was done by Melanie Wright, Renee Robinson, Jared Barrett, Mary Van Molken, and Elaine Wynn. This group reviewed grants and provided feedback to investigators. If you haven't taken advantage of these kinds of opportunities, please do, because this group is very supportive and obviously very much interdisciplinary and collaborative. Tori Sharp left a nice quote for that NIH grant review. She said, "Thanks to the ICHR mock review team, the feedback provided through this valuable exercise was thoughtful and specific. Participating in this process helped us identify areas to strengthen our proposal and provided the team with an energizing boost as we buckled down to work on the revisions." The group's goals for 2021 include advancing project ideas relative to strategic extramural funding opportunities, enhancing interprofessional collaborations to support collaborative research and funding success, and to conduct education and training to assist new researchers in navigating both internal processes and that of external funding agencies. They also work hand in hand with the CTRIN, and the CTRIN has a lot of different both faculty development as well as funding opportunities that are available. And this group helps to funnel that to the faculty that have an interest in doing this. You can join by visiting their website, and they're establishing some upcoming spring meeting dates. I mentioned the CTRIN. This is the Clinical Translational Research Infrastructure Network out of the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. These folks have been our partners for about 7 years and have provided Idaho State with a tremendous amount of pilot grant funding. These are the four pilot grants that made it through the internal process and that are moving on to be evaluated by the CTRIN for funding. Tori Sharp submitted a telehealth delivery of intensive comprehensive aphasia programs for rural stroke survivors. Ali Habashi and Mary Neese looking at health disparities and how that might affect COVID recuperation in minority populations with a variety of different bioindicators. Gabe Bargan and Danny Zhu are looking at hearing loss due to drug-induced hearing loss due to cisplatin and whether esomeprazole may help with that. And Nikki Abishan and the reciprocity team. Nikki Abishan is in the psychology department looking at associations among maternal prenatal health, infancy markers, and childhood obesity in rural areas. So this group, CTRIN, funds projects related to health disparities, particularly those affecting folks in the Intermountain West. And I would encourage all of you to look at these funding opportunities moving forward, but also receiving the support of the ICHR. There was an internal review panel chaired by Marv Schulte from the College of Pharmacy, with Jim Lai, Jared Barrett, Evan Papa, Nancy Devine, Jim Groom, and Mona Zhu as the panelists that reviewed and vetted these proposals to make sure that ISU had strong proposals moving forward to the CTRIN. And I wanted to thank them for taking the time to do that. So just a little bit of statistics about our grants and contracts. We have a really nice increase in our number of submissions for FY21. The dollars submitted also has increased substantially. I mean, you can see since 19, we've nearly doubled the submission amount. And I really, really appreciate the work that people are doing here. Awards received is actually down slightly, but when you look at the dollars received for those awards, it's actually up. And obviously, that's an important metric as well. I'm going to transition now just to talk a little bit about Faculty Senate. These are your senators from the College of Pharmacy, College of Health, Meridian at-large representative, and we have three other at-large representatives from the division. There are several things that this group and the Faculty Senate in general wanted us to talk about, and that is be engaged in the budget process. There's a faculty staff engagement plan for every department or college, and please take the opportunity to participate in that. Same thing with the policy review. Several policies are being reviewed and developed. This occurs continuously in conjunction with our policies office, which is in the office of the president, but works very closely with the Faculty Senate. And there are announcements that come out when these policies are released for 30-day review. Please take part in that and track that and provide feedback as appropriate. The Faculty Senate and Academic Affairs have also created a COVID-19 impact subcommittee. This is developed to better understand and address the impacts of COVID, both negative and positive, on the faculty and the learning environment, research environment, et cetera. This survey is being developed and will be sent to faculty this semester. So please participate, provide that feedback on the impacts of COVID and how the university can better support our faculty in dealing with these issues. Faculty Senate also wants to reiterate that in shared government, faculty must engage. I can sense a little frustration here on the part of the faculty senators. They want to hear from the other faculty, and that engagement can be in many forms, but it includes serving as a senator for one, but also serving on some of the work groups and providing feedback to your Faculty Senate reps as appropriate. Just a little bit of KDHS news. Over the fall semester, we had some really cool things happen. And one of those was Brian Austin is the principal investigator on $1 million grant to cover tuition and fees for students in clinical rehab counseling. This is a brand new program at ISU. And we really appreciate the efforts of Brian and the other faculty members to get this program off the ground. We are adding faculty in the Department of Counseling, and this program has really gotten a boost in the arm with this grant. Cindy Bundy in the PA program received the 2020 William H. Marquardt Community Health Access Fellowship Award, a really super program there. And three ISU faculty and staff were among the six Idaho healthcare professionals who received the Idaho Rural Health Hero Award. That's Riley O'Neill in our AHEC program, Melody Weaver in nursing, and Kathy Oliphant in the College of Pharmacy. So three of the six Idaho Health, Rural Health Hero Awards went to ISU faculty and staff. And I think that's an outstanding representation. We're obviously in the process of expanding and opening the expanded clinics on the Meridian campus. I got to go over there. I've only made one trip to Meridian in about 10 months, but I got to go over there when Teresa Connor was here interviewing and saw the remodel. It looks fantastic. And I think all of you that are going to be able to utilize those new facilities for care and for interdisciplinary education, it's going to be fantastic. Our family medicine physicians have been involved in a wilderness medicine curriculum, and this curriculum has also been training additional ski patrol members for Pebble Creek. Jerry West has awarded Idaho State a $30,000 sports nutrition partnership grant, and Natalie Christensen and others in dietetics have been very heavily involved in this. And obviously ISU and CIF and other entities have teamed up in vaccination programs. We're going to be moving forward with some partnered vaccination programs with Southeast Idaho and very likely in the Treasure Valley as well. You may have heard that we shipped freezers statewide for COVID-19 vaccine storage. One of ours is in North Idaho and one is in Southeast Idaho from ISU, and we appreciate the College of Pharmacy and the Department of Anthropology sharing their freezers for this important public health need. Dental Hygiene Clinic and Ryan Giruff and the folks in dental hygiene should be congratulated. A $500,000 donation from Delta Dental to enhance our dental hygiene clinic. Many aspects of that clinic are 30 years old, maybe more. And so this will really enhance the student learning experience in the dental hygiene clinic. So thank you all for your efforts there. And you can check out our news archive for all kinds of stories that are out there at this website. And thanks, Leanne, and your team for creating the publicity around all of these fantastic things and many others. There's a lot to share about all the work that you all are doing. I wanted to highlight a few things that our students have done this semester too. In our Public Health Student Association, you may have seen some of the videos that they created for the candle test, for face masks, for example, and some of the other public health messages that they've created. They really did a great job. So thanks to them. Our student pharmacists are standing by in Idaho and Alaska to give COVID vaccines. I know that our nursing students are doing the same, as well as our PA students have been involved in some of these efforts. So appreciate everybody, not just in the vaccine arena, but the care that our students have contributed in the care of patients with COVID and other conditions during the pandemic. I want you all to make sure that you note that we need nominations for distinguished faculty. Those recognized will be honored during a reception in April and during commencement. The nominations are due next Friday, January 29th, and we always have good representation of the division, but we want to make sure we do again this year. Here's the website for that. It's off the Academic Affairs webpages for ISU Faculty Awards for fiscal year 21. Also, KDHS Research and Scholarship Day is occurring on April 9th. The theme is technology and healthcare. It'll occur in a virtual format via Zoom. Pre-registration is required and will be available starting February 1 at isu.edu/KDHS Research Day. Thanks to the committee for getting that ready to go again this year. I always put a plug in for our calendar, so please feel free to email kdhs-calendar@isu.edu for events that are occurring all across the division and in your units, and we'll get those up on the calendar. You can subscribe to this calendar so you have it as a Google Cal within your own apps. And again, we're going to ask for feedback. I've saved 20 minutes of our hour and a half, but I've been talking for a long time. And we'd like to get your feedback, what you think about how we do these opening assemblies and the information that we share, the format that we share it in, the content that we share. We'd like to hear from you. And like I said, hopefully we'll be enjoying street tacos come the fall opening assembly. So Ginny, I'm going to take a breath finally and let you fire off some questions. I haven't had a chance to look in the chat at all. I'm going to stop my screen share and I'm going to move to that other slideshow where we're going to cycle through the new employees of the division while we do the Q&A.
Perfect. Thanks, Rex. And then Leanne tells me that you're going to, you all will be sending a follow-up survey for feedback on process and scheduling.
That's correct. Yep. Let me just Perfect. Share that other slideshow and then we'll fire up the questions here. Can you guys see that?
Yes. Okay. Title screen says new employees. Okay. And there's Gabe. Okay. Well, Rex, I'm about to put you on the spot again. You ready?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. So back to the COVID screening. The question is, are those that have not yet signed up for the COVID screens faculty, staff, or students?
All of the above. You know, there are exemptions out there. You know, if folks really have a telecommuting agreement in place and they're not going to be on campus at all, or students that are taking all online, they can fill out an exception form through that process. There's been emails that have gone out about that, but they are all of the above in terms of who we initially identified as the target population for screening, recognizing that some of those folks could have had COVID already, could be fully vaccinated even by today, or could be in one of those other exception groups. And there are ways to fill out your information if you fit in one of those exception groups so that you don't have to participate in the screening. But otherwise, we're expecting people who are gonna have an on-campus presence during the semester to be a part of the screening, this back to campus screening that goes through the 29th of January.
Great, thanks, Rex. Also related to COVID, if we get vaccinated through SIPH, is ISU wanting to know we were vaccinated?
Yes, we are. And right now, you know, if you're vaccinated, you can upload that information to sort of accept out of the screening process as we move forward, because we know some vaccinations will occur well into the spring, continue well into the spring. We'll have a process whereby we can track that. We don't have a mandate for mandatory vaccination on campus, however, and I personally will be surprised if we come out with a mandatory one, but that may be the president and administrative council's decision. But we do want you to upload that as you're going through it, because that accepts you out of the screening process at the present time.
Excellent, thanks, Rex. Next up is a budget question. Do indirect costs from grants get sent to the division? And if so, what is the percentage of those dollars?
So the division keeps none of the indirect cost. I have always, as long as I've been in this job, and frankly, as when Linda Hatzenbuehler was leading the Division of Health Sciences, pushed the indirect cost recovery back to the academic units. Now, the deans have some say in how that gets distributed back to the department and the investigator, but that all that comes back to the academic unit passes through the DHS to the colleges.
Okay, perfect. Next is, what is the status of occupational therapy expanding to Meridian?
Well, at the present time, our plan for expansion is to begin hiring some of those faculty and for expansion to occur in the fall of 2022.
Okay, great. Regarding the diversity initiative, if someone is super interested in joining, how do they reach out about that?
Shoot Connie an email. She's helping me organize that, Connie Tillotson, and we'll reach out to you. We're trying to keep the group. We want to have several different groups. We want to have a diverse group. We want to have several different groups represented, but we don't want it to be too large and not nimble. But absolutely, if you have a passion there, let us know.
Okay, perfect. I have a note here to share that the Research Council is collecting suggestions on things that the Office of Research might do to help encourage faculty application to external research grants. And you can send suggestions to Barb Gordon, who is the KDHS rep on the Research Council.
Thanks, Barb. Appreciate that.
Okay, back to COVID screening for a second. We have adjunct faculty members who live in other states who do not come to any ISU campuses. They are receiving the out of compliance emails. Is there any way to exempt online only adjunct faculty members?
Yeah, we should be able to do that. I don't exactly know the process to do it. Chris, I'm going to put you on the spot. Do you have any thoughts about how we could do that? Because I agree, you know, they shouldn't be getting the emails. Is there an exemption process for adjuncts that never come to campus? There should be.
There should be, but yeah, that's something that we'll get right on then. Yeah, I don't know that we've...
This is Barbara Kornblau and from occupational therapy, and I'm from out of state. Yeah. And I was sent an email that gave me an option to ask for an exemption. And I did, and they answered right away and said, thanks, you don't come to campus, you're exempt.
Okay. Thanks, Barbara. Appreciate that. Yeah, we've tried to think of every contingency as we've been planning this, but it's tricky. There are lots of exceptions.
Okay. And I have a note that if we can get a listing of those adjunct faculty, they can be updated in the system as remote.
Okay.
Somebody from IT. Okay. Okay. So we have a note that faculty feedback has been fantastic from those working with Irene Van Worden. Thank you. And wanted to know if Irene is a part or full-time resource for statistical consulting, and is the search for a biostatistician ongoing?
So Irene, as part of her job description, is available for consultation, but we have to obviously balance that. I'll have to go back and look at where we are with some of our other searches to figure out where other biostatistical consultation is going to be coming from.
Perfect. And then Cassidy has posted a link on the COVID screening site to fill out the online employee form on the webpage if you need to do that. Okay. Rex, I believe that's all the questions that we have. So I think at this point, I'll turn it back over to you for any closing thoughts for us.
Yeah, and I can actually go back to the biostats thing quickly. One of the other things is, I think most of you know on the Meridian campus, at least, that Rick Tivis departed it was either during the summer or early fall. And we have not decided what we're going to do with that line and with that position at the present time. That'll be discussed as we go through the budgeting process.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah, sure.
That just came in? Thank you. Yeah. The question is, when will the KDHS annual report be released? And acknowledging all units that have been successful in obtaining external funding would increase faculty engagement and research.
Sounds good. We usually work on that annual report each spring. That's part of pulling together all of that information and part of the reports that I provide both the president and provost that I report up to. So Connie usually helps me do that. We'll be working on that in February. I would guess that it will be ready in March. And you're absolutely right. We want to acknowledge all the work that goes on in the division, whether it's service or scholarship. And I am happy to highlight that. I would also encourage you to reach out to Leanne anytime we have great stories to tell, because we're always looking for content to push out. We can do that.
Okay, and I'm having some technical issues on my end. Leanne, if you could post Connie's email for anybody who's interested in the diversity initiative, that would be super helpful, like half online and half not here.
It's TillConn, TillConn at ISU.edu.
Thank you.
It's an easy one.
Perfect. I think that's it for me and for questions, Rex. So now I will turn it back over to you.
Okay. Well, thanks everybody. We obviously fed you a lot of information, and I mean what I say about the feedback, the content that we provide, the you know, the different things that we cover in this meeting. If you want more detail in certain areas, just let us know, because we do want to get the feedback from all of you about making sure that the lines of communication are as open as they can possibly be. These are obviously challenging times to get the word out. And we get complaints that we're not always as communicative as people want us to be. And so any suggestions that you have for us to be able to improve, we'll certainly take a look at those, and we'll change what we do here and change what we do in terms of overall communication within the division. I want to thank all of you for everything that you're doing. I miss seeing you all in person. I know I've staffed the screening site a few times over the first few weeks of the screening, and it was nice just to be able to give somebody a fist bump or an elbow bump that I hadn't seen in a long, long time. So it's even for those of us that are fairly introverted most of the time, we're starting to feel the effects of being at the home office and not being able to see people very often. And I know it's difficult. I know that it's difficult not having the same kind of engagement with your students and with your colleagues. But I do think we're starting to see some light at the end of the tunnel here, hopefully. And as the vaccine rolls out and as our disease mitigation efforts continue to stay in place, hopefully we'll continue the trends that we're seeing statewide with lower numbers of COVID, and we'll be back towards a more normal situation in coming months. So thank you for staying strong and staying committed to all that we do in these challenging times, and we'll talk to y'all soon. Thanks, everybody. Have a great weekend and have a great semester, and reach out if you need to chat about things.